Hello everyone, today's video is a bit special because it has a double purpose. First, give KSP players all the necessary tools to build their own DeltaV map. Second, use these tools to build the DeltaV map we need in our Pocket Solar adventure. As a matter of fact, and as we made our first Earth orbit, the logic of this progression is to turn towards the Moon with the first flyby, the first orbit, the first landing of a probe on its surface. We definitely need DeltaV figures to plan such missions. It's only light matters here, and today we are going to deep dive inside orbital mechanics. The Moon revolves around the Earth in an elliptical orbit characterized by a semi-major axis. The semi-major axis is the average distance of the two bodies. Celestial bodies have a radius, a gravitational parameter, a sphere of influence, a delimitation of the atmosphere for the Earth, and a parent body for the Moon. We don't need the mass because it's already included in the gravitational parameter, also named mu. All of these are defined in-game and can therefore be extracted. To do this, we will use a KOS mod which provides a programming language and allows us to interact with the game. With this piece of code, we will be able to output all the characteristics we need in a CSV file. We import this data into a spreadsheet, and it's in this document that we will do all the calculations we need. But before doing them, we must know what we want to calculate and which formulas will have to be used. I did not choose the easy way to start, but it's the first step of any journey. The first question we must ask ourselves is, what altitude do we retain for our low orbit? The game confirms that the space boundary in KSRSS 2.5 is 99,700 meters altitude. Low orbit values are often 10 kilometers above the ground or above the atmosphere. Here it would be 99,700 meters of altitude. So, in our spreadsheet, we are going to create an additional column we call margin, so that the low orbit figure is a round number. For the Earth, we obviously round up to 100 kilometers. It's practical, intuitive, and easy to memorize. I do the same exercise for the other bodies by decreasing the height for those which are very small. This remains quite theoretical because I do not know the height of their highest reliefs. It nevertheless allows us to move forward. Now a question arises, how do we calculate the necessary delta V for takeoff? Well, there is a very simplified approach to calculating this in a vacuum. A. Instantaneous change from a stationary situation to an orbit at the same zero altitude. B. First part of a Hummel transfer to reach target altitude. C. Second part of a Hummel transfer to a circularize at target altitude. So, how do we do A? Well, the quantity of velocity to be acquired is therefore the speed of a body in orbit at a zero altitude. The speed of a circular orbit is given by this formula. The velocity is the square root of the mu and radius ratio. So at a zero altitude, R is the radius of the planet, and as we have recovered mu and the radius of the Earth from KOS, we can calculate the value, which is 3,836 meters per second. For B, the calculation is given by the following formula, where mu is the gravitational parameter of the Earth, R1 is the Earth radius, and R2 is the Earth radius plus the low Earth orbit altitude. We can make a numerical application. It gives a little bit more than 61 meters per second. Then we do C, we apply another formula for the second part of Hummel transfer. We already have the elements. We can also find out the result there, about 60 meters per second. The total theoretical delta V for complete ascent to low orbit and circularization is therefore the sum of these three values, which is 3,958 meters per second. We can now calculate all ascent values of all bodies in our spreadsheet, except of course for the Sun and gas planets, because it would not make much sense. You will have noticed the limits of this method. Because maneuvers are instantaneous, they totally neglect gravitational losses. Also, any friction of the atmosphere is omitted. Last, there are high speed losses, because engines are more efficient in a vacuum than at sea level. I consulted a work made by Romain Poirier regarding orbital mechanics. For a sample and representative rocket, collected data of a typical launch from Kerbin give a total DeltaV spent of 3016, the sum of all losses being 749. The theoretical DeltaV should have been 3016 minus 749, which gives 2267 meters per second. We can find out the multiplicator to be applied on the theoretical DeltaV. It's 1.33. Well, we apply this 1.33 factor on the theoretical DeltaV we got for the Earth, which gives us 5264 meters per second. For the Moon, there is no atmosphere, so no drag and no high speed losses. Moreover, any lander would have a much higher TWR on the Moon than a rocket on the Earth. Romain Poirier gives the following clue, where V0 is the orbital speed and the TWR the thrust to weight ratio of a rocket on the ground. We can see that gravitational losses are directly related to the TWR of a craft. The less you burn and the sooner you accelerate horizontally, the less the losses. What we are going to do is, for every other body than the Earth, estimate what could be a TWR to land on these bodies. In fact, we don't build a lander for Ryugu like we would for Mars. For each body, we are going to decide which percentage of losses we will apply. It gives two new columns. Mars and Titan are a bit tricky. One has a very thin atmosphere, the second is a small body with a thick atmosphere. These values will have to be fine-tuned later. Be aware that these numbers, if used for landing perspective, are meant for a perfect suicide burn maneuver. You should really take a margin. I recommend 20% for beginners if you have to land on these bodies. This concludes our first point. We have all ascent values for every celestial body. We can already do more with what we just learned. We can compute the orbital velocities of all low orbits with the first formula we saw. That's not all. We can also calculate the average speed of a body around another one. The average distance of a small body to its parent is its semi-major axis. We will use this value as a radius in the same formula. This maneuver is simply the first part of a Hohmann transfer we just saw in the previous point. The starting orbit is the low Earth orbit, which radius is R1. The final orbit has a major axis characterized by the sum of the Earth-Moon distance and R1. The average distance of these two bodies is a semi-major axis of the Moon orbit, which is R2. We therefore apply this formula to give us the delta V of the translunar injection burn, 1493 meters per second. We take the opportunity to find out the necessary delta V to escape from the Earth's SOI, 1519 meters per second, with the help of the same formula. Moreover, with this batch we can more widely calculate all transfers from a low orbit of a planet to its satellites, and all the escape delta V burns for both planets and moons. The aim of this maneuver is the following. If nothing is done, the vessel will enter the moon's sphere of influence, make a flyby, then escape. Our vessel needs to do something at the periapsis of its hyperbolic orbit so that its velocity matches the orbital velocity in low orbit. In the same maneuver, the vessel will perform the capture and the circularization maneuver. As we just saw, circularizing in low orbit requires knowing how much the speed will be when the ship is at the periapsis of its hyperbolic orbit. We already know the orbital velocity of the low lunar orbit. We saw it in the ascent chapter. What we need is the velocity at the periapsis. For this, it's necessary to characterize this hyperbolic orbit. A body in orbit around a bigger one has a specific energy. It's the sum of its kinetic and potential energy. It's described by the Viver equation. V is the orbital velocity of the small body, R the distance of the small body to the larger one, and A the semi-major axis of the orbit if circular or elliptical. Under the effect of the force of gravity alone, this energy does not vary over time. If the body approaches its parent, the speed increases. If it moves away, the speed decreases. This therefore means that the energy of our vessel at the periapsis is the same as it enters the moon's SOI. We can transform this writing to get the speed at the periapsis. Here the question of the speed at the periapsis becomes a question of the speed at the entrance in the SOI. So how do we calculate this? Well, we have to make a step back from Earth's perspective. Our ship travels to the moon on its transfer orbit. It is at its closest to our satellite while reaching the apoapsis. If we knew the velocity at the apoapsis, that would be a huge leap forward, isn't it? Well, we have in fact all the necessary tools and values to compute it, with the very same Viva equation, where R is the distance between the vessel and the Earth, A is the semi-major axis of our transfer orbit. As the semi-major axis of the transfer orbit is the sum of the low orbit radius and the semi-major axis of the moon, we can modify our formula and we have the velocity at the apoapsis. But as you can see, this value is only valid for Earth's inertial reference frame inside Earth's SOI. This value must be transformed into a lunar reference in the lunar SOI. We have to remind ourselves that from Earth's perspective, both the moon and the vessel are moving. If we look at the situation when our ship is at the top of its orbit, we notice that its velocity vector goes in the same direction as the moon's. A simple subtraction then gives the velocity of the ship when it enters the moon's SOI. We already know what the average velocity of the moon is, so we determined it earlier. We finally have all the values needed to calculate the delta V that must be spent to circularize in low lunar orbit, and we find 388 meters per second. Furthermore, we can generalize this formula to every circularization of a transfer journey to a body from its parent. We have computed the necessary delta V to be spent to go from a flyby trajectory to a low circular orbit. But we may be interested in burning just the minimal fuel to simply be captured by the moon. Again, we use the Viva equation, which can be wrote like this at the periapsis. Beside the velocity we seek, we have all the elements that we can write. Then a simple subtraction gives the delta V we need for a moon capture. And we find 69 meters per second. We have another approach to determine this value with only one operation. We already know how much delta V must be spent to escape the moon from low orbit. We saw that with the transfer orbit calculations. This value is therefore the same as doing the opposite maneuver, which would be going from an elliptic orbit whose periapsis is the low moon orbit and whose apoapsis is the edge of the moon's SOI. We already know how much delta V must be spent to go from a flyby to circularization. We just have to do a subtraction, which fortunately gives the same 69 meters per second. With all the values we have determined, we are now able to build the delta V map we need for Earth-Moon journeys. The only thing we lack is to know the necessary delta V for a ship to leave the lunar SOI in order to return to Earth. Well, this is the easiest case. Just repeat the numbers in reverse order and that's all. Moreover, with a small additional push, you can plot the periapsis of the transfer orbit inside the Earth's atmosphere and go back home directly with an aerobraking maneuver. With this work of analysis and calculations, we have not only determined everything needed to make an Earth-Moon trip, but we suddenly have the method to constitute a very large part of a delta V map, not only for our solar system, but also for any planet modpack whose community has not yet produced any map. We will still have some work to do, but this addition will be the subject of another video. Take care and don't forget, today is still stadopt.